shelter, the stars are shining bright. Some may call me a drifter, but I know that they are wrong, and I don't know where I'm going. Only know where I'm coming from. I don't know where I'm going. Only know where I'm coming from. I see all those people driving in their shiny cars, hanging out in the stations and loitering in bars. They got that look in their eye like they don't know where they belong. The stars are shining bright. Some may call me a drifter, but I know that they are wrong, and I don't know where I'm going. Only know where I'm coming from. I don't know where I'm going. Only know where I'm coming from. Well, the sun is on the rise.
Yeah, I've got some more oranges.
Okay. Oh, cool. Thank you.
Thomas, you want the rest of this?
Oh, yeah. Thanks a lot.
Wow, there's a lot of them, huh?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah? Okay. Mm. Do you think we need more oatmeal?
I think that'll do.
Hey, Cynthia.
Yeah?
Do you want to do lunch with me?
Yeah, okay. Let's talk later. We can figure out what we're going to make.
Okay, cool.
Okay.
It was just Pete and I. We had a vision and we came here and we were completely embraced by the Portuguese and we loved it here. And we came in October and it rained for 3 weeks and we were in a tent and we were completely soaked most of the time, but we just still loved it. The first day we came here, the person who showed us the land, it was completely covered in brambles. We couldn't see hardly any of it. We went to the other side of the valley and we looked across, and when I looked across, I saw the whole thing completely done. So we had the vision, we finally got the place, we had the background of, you know, experience of what works, what doesn't work, And then people started to come. So we didn't go out looking to build a community. In fact, we were kind of like not wanting to have a community because we had just lived in community. But what we realized is when people came and they were lit up by our vision and we were following something that was beyond our own ideas, there were a few people that actually were so lit up by the vision that they just wanted to stay and actually create it with us. And so then those people decided, the first were two people, Adam and Mim, and they ended up where they were going to come for 3 months, and then it made sense where maybe they stayed for a year. And then Laura came, and Glenn came, and it made sense to just say, hey, Laura, what are you going to do? You know, after your month here, what are you going to do? And so she said, I want to stay. And so we said, great. And then she said, I'll stay indefinitely. And then the other, you know, Mim and Adam were like, well, I want to stay indefinitely too. And so it just kind of built. And the mystery of the whole place is that anytime we needed people with specific skills, they seemed to show up. And whether they came for a short period of time or a long period of time, it didn't really matter. It's like what we needed was actually given, and we responded each time. So even though we weren't looking for a community, that's what was happening, so that's what we responded to. And so over time, it's just trying to continue to create this place and continue to like be on our own edge, and for all the people that are here now to do the same thing. But part of creating this community is not growing too big, because there's a lot of people that want to come and be part of a community. But this community really is about transcending ego, and it's about living in an evolutionary context, and it's very challenging, and it is not for everybody.
When I meditate, I change my point of reference. And without experiencing it, it can only be words, what the beauty of that change of reference means. It means that I'm bigger than this small me, I'm bigger than my body. It also means I'm not my thoughts.
As we all meditate individually, but as we meditate together, we actually create a field of this unity or this oneness. You actually go to that place where you're only pure consciousness, and that place is the same for all of us. So when we all go to that place of pure consciousness, we are that one consciousness. So the meditation is the foundation of not only an individual spiritual path, but it's the foundation of what we're doing here as a community, and it's the foundation of a collective, you know, a collective emergence of this one consciousness coming through the many individuals in their many, many different, you know, expressions.
There are more and more people, especially young people, who feel a change has got to come, right? That things cannot carry on the way they have been. And I think this is becoming very obvious now in all dimensions and fields, that if we just carry on doing more of the same, everything's going to continue to collapse.
So what I'm talking about is that really destructive part of us that doesn't seem to be able to live well together, that insists on separation. So our individuality is fantastic, but although we have that individuality, we are also all one. And if we can come to that, then everything is different. We take every situation and respond differently.
So, ego in this context doesn't just mean one's sense of individuality. Basically, all of the structures, patterns in us that keep us down, keep us where we are, and inhibit our higher evolution.
What I mean by being one, something that comes when we meditate is the experience that we aren't separate. There is only one. And living from that place, with that as a reference, everything changes, everything is different. So even though you and I have unique qualities, we are bringing those qualities as part of this oneness, that everything, all the creativity, all the wonder of this world, all the, just everything that is all one.
The truth is that there's only one life, one consciousness, one energy, one source, whatever word we want to use. You know, some people call it God. There's just one energy, one life that's animating all of us and also the whole process of life here.
So this is the hydro system, which generates most of our power in the Pinto. It's definitely a work in progress. It's one of the examples of when something starts to become working, we kind of take a step back and experiment a little bit with it. And the way that it works is the water comes in from this pipe here, which comes 300 meters around from the mountain up there, where there's a tank coming straight from the river. So the water, the pressure in the pipe is created by about 15 meter drop from where the water enters at the stream. And it's really simple. The water just shoots into this where there's a jet, and it turns this motor, which generates enough electricity for the whole Pinto. So fire it up. Now that's running, so we just leave it for months, and that's all you have to do.
So, we've got a couple of things going on here. We're putting potatoes in this bed where the soil is not so good. And the potatoes are fantastic because they're going to break up a lot of the soil. What we're trying to do here and all over the Pinto is create soil. And we do that by feeding the microorganisms in the soil. But we don't want to bring inputs from outside. We don't want to use chemicals, obviously, and we don't want to bring in anything from outside as far as possible. We want to keep things in a closed loop. And the reason for that is we're trying to work with nature. and we're mimicking what nature does. And if you look in a natural forest system, everything's there. It's just cycled round and round. The nutrients are cycled round, the water's cycled round. So that's what we're imitating in our system. So what we're using for fertility on the beds is the donkey poo. And the great thing about the donkey poo is that the donkeys are given the scraps from the kitchen, and then they're like juices. They goes through their system, comes out this incredible fertile black gold, which we can then put on the food. And then when the food is grown and we eat it, we'll give those scraps to the donkeys and the whole cycle started again. So in an ideal system, it's completely closed and cyclical. Is to keep the cycle even more closed with the people is we can use our own humanure that we collect from the compost toilets, and we can use that for fertilizer. So that means we eat the food, we deposit the food, we use the deposits to grow the food, and so we've got a complete cycle going around. And look, we got a worm! And that's really exciting. That's what this type of gardening is all about. It's not about, you don't have your eye on the food so much, but on the soil, and you're feeding these microorganisms because they are making available all the nutrients that are needed for the plants. So if you have a healthy soil, you have healthy plants and therefore vegetables. So this area is the perennial and forest garden. And this is where we're growing and using plants that we don't need to grow by seed every year. So they just put them in, and then again, just feed the soil. And if I feed the soil feeds the plants. So for example here, instead of taking these plants, these weeds out, I just chop them down, and this is food for the soil microorganisms and protection for the bare soil. And so the fertility is all in one place. Once I've designed it and we've put the different plants in, it's just a case of looking after the soil. It's so easy. And in a few years, when this area and other areas are really established, really the only work we have to do is harvesting. We just come and pick the fruits. Quite a few years ago, I moved to the countryside in Wales, and I thought, okay, well, because I'd always craved meat. I'd always really, really wanted meat, but just didn't eat it. And then I thought, okay, well, I'm here, organic, happy cows everywhere. I'll have some happy cow. And I sat down to eat it. I made myself a curry or something. And I actually couldn't eat it. My body, by that point, just rejected it. So, yeah, I mean, there's no way I could eat our chickens, for example. That just makes... That'd be like eating dwart, you know. So, I wouldn't want to be involved in... happy animal rearing, though I believe that maybe that's the appropriate thing for some people. You know, I don't know. I think different bodies at different times might need meat or not. But I know for me right now, I really don't need it. And I think actually it would be bad for my system. So for me, it's just not a question anymore. But I think other people really have to go deep into their own experience to find out what the right thing is for them. But I think the worst thing I see, though, is when people really, really care about animals, about suffering, about cruelty, but just don't want to look at the meat that they're eating. And still buy the meat that is contributing towards that. So that's something to look at. But yeah, it's a question whether if people eat happy meat, that's okay for them.
Is that
you get nervous.
say. It's called in English.
This is not
So there's a lot of people who feel like we need a new economic system, we need to obviously save the environment, we need to address issues of poverty and overpopulation, etc. And these are all very important issues that need to be addressed. But what is often missed is that the root cause of all our suffering and strife and division and war and conflict, etc., is our level of consciousness. Do you feel that we've reached the end? You see, most human beings don't really question that. They don't really open themselves up to, well, actually, maybe we're still in the process of evolving. Maybe humanity, as it is right now, is a transitional being on the way to a greater expression, an evolution of whatever humanity would be. And I think, you know, our evolution at our time, it's really about the evolution of our consciousness. And so the evolution of consciousness is all about transcending ego consciousness.
Around the fire with the off-grid blues.